in this video lecture, we're going to focus on the three forces that drive surface winds. The three forces that drive surface winds. There are three of them, as I just said. We have the pressure gradient force. That's the first force. Pressure gradient is the change in pressure over distance. So for example, if we go from high to low, the highest values are here, the lowest values are here, we go this way, we change pressure. So that is a gradient. It's a change in pressure over distance, the pressure gradient force. The second force is the Coriolis force. The Coriolis force is the influence of Earth's rotation on an object that is not attached to the Earth. So what we get is, in the Northern Hemisphere, objects are diverted to the right because they're not attached to Earth's rotation. In the Southern Hemisphere, they are diverted to the left because they are not attached to the Earth's rotation. So for example, if you look here at this pendulum, the pendulum is not attached to the Earth at all. It is swinging by the use of magnets. And as the Earth underneath the pendulum rotates to the right, or the left, the object falls to the right. So that pendulum is swinging, it will hit the object to the immediate right as the Earth underneath it is spinning to the left. If you fly from San Francisco to New York and your pilot does not correct for Coriolis, you could end up in Miami. Probably a better place to end up. But again, you are influenced by Coriolis. When you drive, when you walk, you are influenced minutely on a very small scale. A very small scale, Coriolis. Coriolis is greater at the North Pole and South Pole and is not a major influence at the tropics or the equator. So we take these two forces, we add them together, we are getting winds that are flowing across isobars to the right. Now, the last force is friction. Friction, the last force we add, it is pulling back the wind. It is dragging the wind. Friction is caused by vegetation, by the topography, hills, flat land, mountains. It is caused by buildings. Anything that's at the surface that causes wind to be pulled back or slowed down. When you add all three of these winds, these forces together, you get a resultant wind that crosses isobars at 45 degree angles. The winds flow at the Northern Hemisphere to the right at 45 degree angles across isobars. Now, let's have a look at this graphically, or using an image and each of these forces, building each of these forces. Here's a low pressure, isobar, isobar, isobar. And I'm going to go ahead and put the values out here so you can see that there's a change in pressure as we go north. So here is 1020 millibars. It's a higher pressure. 1016 millibars. And then 1012 millibars. And then a low pressure. So for every 4 millibars, we draw an isobar, an equal line of pressure. Pressure gradient, again, is that change in pressure over distance. So that's pressure gradient force. We are changing pressure as we go north. Then we add Coriolis. It causes the winds to move to the right because Coriolis, the Earth's influence, rotation on an object that's not attached to the Earth, in this case wind, moves to the right. Southern Hemisphere, left, left. Then we add the third force, that is friction. It pulls back. It pulls back on that wind. It drags it. The resultant wind direction, when we add all three forces together, is going to be winds that cross isobars at 45 degree angles. Winds will the winds will cross isobars at 45 degree angles. So again, we have pressure gradient force, Coriolis, friction, the resultant wind is 45 degree angles across isobars. Now let's do some wind directions around two pressure cells, so that you can see how the resultant wind works. We have a high pressure here, we have a low pressure here. We're in the northern hemisphere. We'll put one isobar around the high pressure cell, we'll put one isobar around the low pressure cell. Now let's go ahead and put stations here. And what we're looking for are winds that cross isobars at 45 degree angles. So we'll use this station here. What we use is we see the station on an isobar, 45 degree angle. The winds are going away from the center of the high pressure to an area of lower pressure. Winds cross isobars at 45 degree angles. Thus, here's another one. Air moves from high to low, high to low, high to low, high to low, 45 degree angles, high to low, high to low, high to low, high to low. This wind direction is from the southwest. This wind direction is from the southeast. This wind is from the east, and this wind is from the north. We read wind direction as coming from. So the winds are coming from the southwest here. The winds are coming from the north here. The winds are coming from the east here. The winds are coming from the southeast here. All of these winds are going out of the high pressure cell. The wind flow around the high pressure is spiraling outward clockwise. Spiraling outward clockwise. Now, let's go to the low pressure and do the same thing. In this case, the winds are going from high to low. So therefore, at 45 degree angles, winds will go from higher to lower pressure. Higher to lower pressure. Higher to lower pressure. Higher to lower pressure. So these winds here are from the east. These winds are from the north. These winds are from the south, from the west. And then this wind is from the south. So we've got wind flow crossing isobars at 45 degree angles. Here's east, here's north. Winds are coming from the west, winds are coming from the south. Again, the winds are going from a higher pressure to a lower pressure, coming into. So in this case, the low pressure, we have winds that spiral inwardly counterclockwise.